Hello, everyone. There were two library sales in my general vicinity over the past couple of weeks, and my new bookish friends wanted to go, so I went too. And despite the fact that I do not have any room on my shelves for unread books, I bought stuff, so let's talk about it. The first sale was a couple of weeks ago, and it was a very small sale, so I didn't end up getting very many things because I didn't end up finding almost anything that I was really interested in, and I am free to blame one of my classmates because he openly said that he probably took all the good stuff. He got there before all of us did, and he ended up buying at least two tote bags worth of things, and he's interested in the same kinds of things I am. He went to poetry first, so that's like the kind of person he is. So he took all of the really great stuff, and all that was really left was like James Patterson and Danielle Steele and Nora Roberts. So it was a little bit slim pickings, which explains the first three books that I got because I didn't want to walk out of the sale empty-handed. I wanted to support the library. I wanted to support the sale. I also wanted books, selfishly. And so I got some things that I will end up reading, but they probably aren't things that I would have bought otherwise. I know, it's not the greatest reasoning. And the first two books I have an explanation for because I would describe them as what I call book candy, which means that I don't expect them to be amazing. I don't expect them to have like a long-lasting impression on me. I probably won't remember them, but they will be really enjoyable while I'm consuming them, and they will serve the purpose that I want them to serve. Because there are some days where I am feeling like I want to read something that's like really emotionally weighty and beautiful and moving and amazing, but there are a lot of days where I don't feel like investing my energy in that, and I want to still curl up with a book and enjoy myself, but I don't want to try as hard, which is weird for me because that's usually what I like to do. I like reading things that have a lot of emotional weight to them, and require that emotional investment, but I haven't had a lot of space for that recently, and that's most of the unread books that I own. So that is the very long preface to say that's why I bought these books, which are A Great and Terrible Beauty and Rebel Angels by Libba Bray. I specifically picked these out because I've heard good things about Libba Bray. I know people mostly talk about her Diviners series, but they didn't have that. They had these. So I got these. I also know that Jean over at Jean Bookish Thoughts has read these and has talked highly of them. So that's an endorsement I can at least get behind a little bit. These are pretty much all I know about them is that they're Victorian historical fiction and that they're YA. That's all I feel like I need to know. And yeah, my expectations I think are reasonably low, but I also feel like they will serve the exact purpose that I bought them for. So I don't have any regrets. And the only other thing that I bought at that sale was Garden Spells by Sarah Addison Allen, which I bought because I've heard this talked about on the All the Books podcast before by Jen, I think, and she has talked highly of it. I can't remember in what context, but from what I can glean from the back cover, it's not entirely clear what's going on, but it does seem to be about a magical family, potentially of all women, and one of them is estranged and comes back home, so it's like family drama with potential magic, and I'm here for that. So hopefully this is good too. And then the second sale I went to, partially because it was only three blocks away from my house and there was like a street festival happening at the same time, so we checked out the book sale and the festival, and it was really fun, and it was a much better sale. They had a lot more selection, a lot more things that really catered to my taste, and just more books in general. It was a much more widely attended sale. So many people came that they kept putting new things on the shelves to replenish the stock, and then I kept finding other things that I was interested in. It was a vicious cycle. I had to leave, and I ended up even putting things back. So this is me being restrained. I didn't even fill my tote bag up all the way, so I was well-ish behaved. And all told, these books plus the ones that my partner bought were only $10, so I don't feel that bad about it, even though I don't know where they're gonna go. Future Sabrina will figure that out. So the first one that I got is Wide Sargasso Sea by Jean Rhys. I have really been wanting to read this since I read Jane Eyre for the second time and learned that this existed. But my interest in Jean Rhys as an author specifically was piqued when I read The Recovering by Leslie Jamison earlier this year. She talks a lot about Jean Rhys and her alcoholism and her writing and how those things kind of went together, and how Jean Rhys as a figure influenced Leslie Jamison as a writer, and her kind of perspective on female alcoholic writers. So I've been interested to read this because I feel like I could get on with Jean Rhys's writing. It's not maybe the one that I'm the most interested in and from her backlog, but it's the one that they had. So I am eager to get to this, especially because I feel like it's almost required reading for if you read Jane Eyre, that you should also check out White Sargasso Sea and view Rochester's Wife from a different perspective, because it is kind of a colonialist background and just, you know, flips the script and all that stuff. So I am curious to read this. I also got a copy of Life After Life by Kate Atkinson because I've read this already and I really wanted my own copy because when I read it on the Kindle from the library and I was also sick. So my memory of reading that book is kind of like a fever dream. And I remember liking it, but I don't remember a lot of specifics. And I just really want to read it with a clear head, basically, so I can then go on to read A God in Ruins. But I've really enjoyed both of the Atkinson novels that I've read and I want to read more for sure. But I think that I will love this all the more if I read it when I'm not like drugged up on cold medicine. So hope that's true. And this is a really easy book to find secondhand. So I figured I might as well just get it for $1 instead of buying a new paperback. I also went to the nonfiction section and I got a couple things. First was Lit by Mary Carr. For being as big a fan of memoirs by women, you'd think that I would have read Mary Carr by now, but I haven't. She is known so well for her memoirs and I really wanted to read them all in order, but they don't have The Liars Club on audio, I don't think. I think I checked and that's what stopped me. And I like reading memoir on audio better, but I felt like, you know, they have it. I can read a memoir in print. It won't be the end of me. And I still might really enjoy it. And because she's known as being such an amazing memoir writer, it's one that I might want to annotate and put sticky tabs into. So I might do that because I do love memoir, especially memoirs by troubled women seems to be a niche that I'm particularly interested in. And I know that this is a memoir about addiction and possibly recovery. I don't know if it goes into recovery, but addiction for sure. And that is a subject that I really like reading about in memoirs for some reason. So really, really glad to have found this. The other work of nonfiction that I got was Behind the Beautiful Forevers by Catherine Boo, which is a work of journalistic writing, I think. It won the National Book Award. I think it also won the Pulitzer Prize. Those are both prizes that if I see something has won it when I'm perusing, I am more likely to pick up the book and at least read the back. And I've heard this talked about really highly for a long time. It is the dramatic story of families striving toward a better life in a makeshift settlement in the shadow of luxury hotels near the Mumbai airport. So I think this could be really good. And I don't really have anything else to say about it. I just felt drawn to it. I've heard it talked about really highly since it won all those awards a few years ago. And I figured I would just pick it up. Okay, so technically this is the one that my partner picked out, but I would have picked it out if I'd found it first. So I'm including it because I feel a dual ownership of this book. And it is The Library of Mount Char by Scott Hawkins. This is a work of, I don't know if it's exactly fantasy, but I know it's weird. And I've heard it talked about very highly as well. And I've been wanting to read it for a long time. I know that it takes place in like a mystical library. The figure that controls the library is kind of like a godlike figure. And I believe he kidnaps children and forces them to specialize in different subjects of the library. And I've heard that it's really dark and violent. I could have gotten the description wrong. I know that I've heard it described as being very, very strange and very disturbing, which are keywords that always pique my interest a little bit. And I just want to get a taste for myself to see if this is the kind of thing that I like, because I think it could go really well or really poorly, depending on the writing and its execution and its characters, of course, because I love good characters. But it's hard to not be drawn to something that has library in the title and is about a library at the point I am in my life. So I feel like it's, you know, at least kind of on brand, and I'm willing to give it a try because, again, I feel like it might fulfill that brain candy thing. So this also will fulfill the brain candy requirement, which is Old Man's War by John Scalzi. I've read a few Scalzi. I know I read Lock-In and Red Shirts. I might have read something else that I can't remember, but I've enjoyed both of those a lot. And part of the reason I enjoyed them so much was because I listened to them on audio and they were narrated by Wil Wheaton. And I think, I don't remember if Wil Wheaton did the audiobooks for these, and I could very easily get the audiobooks for this series, but I thought it'd be really nice to have something physical to read that fulfills the brain candy category again. So I know that this is pretty straightforward sci-fi. It takes place in a future where all of the soldiers that are drafted for war are old people, I don't know why that's a good strategy. It sounds like a bad one, personally, but apparently there's justification for it, so I'm eager to see why. I know I've heard better, more detailed, and probably more accurate descriptions of this book in the past, but I don't remember. So I saw Skullzy, and I was curious, so I decided to buy it. Again, it was a dollar. Also in the sci-fi fantasy section, I was really eager to see some China Mieville. So this is Looking for Jake, which is a collection of short stories. And I wanted this because I read The City in the City earlier this year, and I really enjoyed it. I just want to know more of China Mieville's brain because it's so cool and weird and interesting and goes places that I didn't expect. And the concept and the execution of The City in the City was one of the most unique books I've ever read. So I want to see what he does with short stories because it could be really bonkers and awesome. So he writes almost an intersection of sci-fi fantasy. It's almost like a new category that doesn't have a word, because it's not quite speculative, it's not fabulous, it's not sci-fi, it's not fantasy, it's kind of all of those and none of those at the same time. This is coming from only having read one of his books, so I really want to know more of his stuff, and I'm willing to try pretty much everything that he writes, and this is a lot more accessible for where I am in my life right now than something like Perdido Street Station, which is a beast of a book. It's so long. And I've been really drawn to short stories lately because I have a few collections. And you know, I can at least read a short story a day if I try. I haven't read a short story every day since I started my program, but I do think it's a nice goal to have to try and read, you know, do some leisure reading a day. And if I only get to read one short story, you know, I feel like that's still pretty good. So anyway, I wanted to kind of bulk up my short story repository, so I will always have some if the mood strikes, and so this helps with that. As do the last three books that I picked up, which are all Best American blah blah blah. I'm so articulate. You can't tell that I'm tired at all, can you? So I got the Best American Short Stories of 2007, which was edited by Stephen King. I thought that Stephen King would be a really interesting curator for this collection because he has an interesting brain. I don't necessarily love his writing, but he's an interesting guy. It does say that Karen Russell has a story in here, and I haven't read anything else by any of the other authors that are listed on the back, but Karen Russell is honestly enough of a draw for me, so I got this one. I also got the Best American Short Stories of 2005, which was edited by Michael Chabon, and this has a really interesting list of authors on the back, including Kelly Link, George Saunders, Cory Doctorow, and Alice Munro. So there are other authors listed on here too, but those are the ones that interested me the most. And again, I think that would be really a really good mix of short stories and hopefully also a good introductory point to authors that I might not be familiar with or have never tried. Also, so cute. It has a Borders sticker on the back. I miss Borders. Also from the sci-fi fantasy section, I saw this, which is the Best American Science Fiction and Fantasy of 2017. So, you know, it's also not super old, which was nice to see. And it was edited by Charles Yu, who I haven't read, but he is the author of How to Live Safely in a Science Fictional Universe and Sorry, Please, Thank You, and Third Class Superhero. And I've heard great things about all of his works. He's also one of the lead writers on Westworld, or at least he was at one point. So he has interesting ideas. I haven't watched Westworld. I just know people like it. So I figured you might care. That doesn't really mean much to me. But anyway, that's all to say. It means that he has an interesting perspective because I've heard that his books are really good, and the names in the back were really intriguing because they included N.K. Jemisin and Catherine M. Valenti. I'm not familiar with a lot of the other ones listed on the back here, but those are two authors that I will read pretty much anything by, so I am hoping that I really get some great recs out of here because I'm always looking for new SFF. It's a genre that I'm not as familiar with as literary fiction, so I'm always eager to find new discoveries, new authors to investigate and start reading. So really excited about this as well. And again, it fulfills the whole short story thing. And I couldn't walk out without it. So those are all the things that I picked up over the past couple of weeks from library sales. I shouldn't be buying books anymore, but it's really hard to resist a book that's only a dollar. But at least I won't be buying books full price anytime soon. And hopefully I'll actually read some of these and talk about them in future videos relatively soon, hopefully. Of course, I'd love to hear any of your thoughts that you have on these books if you've read them. And of course, recommendations are welcome as always too. How are you guys doing? How's life? I'd love to hear about all that stuff in the comments down below. And yeah, other than that, thank you all so much for watching. I'll see you next time.